Everybody in this room believes certain things, and what people believe drives how they behave. People are ultimately going to align their behavior with their belief system. We just don't always know what people believe, but we can see how they behave, which informs us. And the outcomes that we get are produced by the behavior we produce. Put those things together, and when you put this whole room together, the level of shared belief that you have is what creates the actual culture. At an individual level, my belief drives my behavior, which produces my outcomes. That's my belief system. Some people call that character, okay? And my character could be one where I believe that I'm more important than all of you, and my behavior ends up being very selfish and self-preservation and pulling from you and keeping from myself. And the outcome of that is, whatever, I get some things, but I turn everybody off and everybody leaves me alone. That's a sign of my character because it's the way I lived out my belief system. A culture is how we share these things together. Does that make sense? It's the beliefs we share in common, the behavior standards we share in common, and the outcomes and experiences that multiple group people of us have and share together. That's what a culture actually is. So when people talk about what's the culture, it's definitely something that we feel, but understand where it comes from. Which of these three things do we feel? Typically, the feeling is then result of watching how people behave, which tells us what they really actually believe. And which of those three are people the best at trying to either fake or hide or shield? And they posture with the belief portion, because why? That's the easiest one to fake. Hard to fake a behavior for too long. And you definitely can't fake an outcome. So a lot of people say, yeah, I'm all about that. But then if you watch their behavior, it doesn't reflect the belief that they say. So the process of setting a culture for this team is this. Here's what the process of setting culture is. What do all of you believe together? What does that look like in behavior? And what result would that produce for you? That's how we set a culture. I lay this out. The purpose of a belief is to produce a behavior. The only way to find out what you believe, there's only one. Only one way to find out what you believe. And what is that? You could ask them, but what? They could lie to you or what? You might even believe them. Telling doesn't reflect beliefs. The only way to measure a belief is to do what? Watch what they do. It's the only way. And the better we start to understand that is this. I'm all about hearing that, and I definitely would like to use language and all this, but the thing I care least about is the beliefs that people say. The thing I care least about are the values a team puts up on the wall. The thing I care least about are what a guy says he's all about. I'm gonna use it as a marker, but the thing that tells me, does he actually believe that, is does he fucking do it? Because what you'll find out is you'll find out that somebody says they believe in a lot of stuff, and then all of a sudden they have to pay a high price for actually doing that thing they say they believe in, and they find out that cost is way too high. So individually, we've got a choice to make. Am I willing to pay a high price to behave in alignment with what I say I believe? And if you won't pay that price, then that belief is pretty shallow. Definitely not World Series level, probably not even that competitive, a lot more mountain of average drifting towards that bottom end, okay? Purpose of a belief, produce a behavior. Purpose of culture is to create behaviors that actually win. Like character drives the man, culture drives the team. That's the relationship. A man behaves in alignment with his character, a team will behave in alignment with its culture. This is the room right here that sets the culture, and I love this environment right here. Here's why I like this. I like this room because the culture is not gonna come from anywhere outside of this room. The culture is only gonna come from inside this room. It's gonna come from you guys. So, on the upside, right, it's like, okay, well, what do we actually believe in? What behavior do we wanna drive, and what do we want the experience of being here to actually be like? Those are decisions that need to get made. We're gonna make those as concrete as possible. So that's why I say own your belief. So let me run through this, and you guys kind of had some thought. But let me run through this and just show you a handful of how beliefs actually start to get situated. So the first is every belief is either chosen or absorbed. And it helps to keep it binary like this because you can't have a belief coming from a source other than one of these two. It got into you somehow. Either you selected it or somebody put it into you and you couldn't keep it out of you and it built into you. The more you investigate yourself to figure out which one of those two beliefs for each one that you hold in your life, the better off you'll be. That'll take your entire life to keep wrestling with. We just want to do today's work, okay? Number two, is your beliefs are foundational or they're situational? The difference between a foundational belief and a situational belief is this. A situational belief, I selectively believe in and apply when it's convenient for me. A foundational belief is something that guides me all the time. And I'll use an example of something that shows up all the time. It's in every clubhouse. It's one of the first conversations that we had when I started, you know, talking with you guys these months ago, is probably the most situational belief that all of us deal with and everybody in your life deals with, is telling the truth. For most people, they say, I believe in honesty, and I call bullshit every time. Because you don't believe in honesty. If we're being truthful, here's what people believe. I believe in selective honesty. That means that I will, because this is what most adults will do. I believe in honesty as long as it doesn't cost me too much to be honest. But if being honest has a really high price at the end, I tend to hide the truth and not pay that full price for being honest. Because on your wedding day, who's married one more time? Anybody have these vows? Hey, I promise to sometimes tell you the truth as long as you're not gonna get too mad at it. And if you feel like you're gonna get too pissy, I'll just hide the truth from you because I don't think you're capable of handling reality. You're actually a pretty fragile person and I recognize that about you. Anybody have those vows? No. No, on our wedding day, you're doing your vows. It's all what? Beautiful. Oh, it's beautiful. It's amazing. And we're going to, oh, we'll always be like this with each other. And then next thing you know, you tell them the truth one time. They get super mad and you're like, I'm not doing that again. And we can laugh all day, but here's the point. Now, the situation that we're in is this. We only tell the truth 80% of the time, and we don't even tell you what 20% of the time we're lying. Now you have to kind of guess whether I'm telling the truth. And then all of a sudden, that relationship starts to get undermined. Same thing here. It's like, you know, if I don't like you, I'm pretty direct with you. And if you're my boy, I kind of dance around it a little bit more. Because why? The guy I don't really like, I'm not worried about hurting his feelings, right? What I'm not here to do, and what I will never do, is tell anybody what to believe. That's not my call. I already know all of you in this room believe different things than I do. And I love that. Because I don't want you to tell me what to believe either. But here's what I'm going to hold all of us to, myself first among us. Is if you say you believe it, one, it better be chosen. And then number two, if you situationally apply it based on the consequences that you face for it, you have immediately gone to an untrustworthy person. You've gone to a soft person. You've gone to an unreliable individual. Not bad, no moral judgment. It's just, I don't know when you're gonna apply it or not. It's a lack of what the word integrity means. Anybody know what the word integrity means? Anybody know like what the actual root word for it is? So the word integrity comes from a Latin word integritas, and it means to be whole. To have integrity is a very simple thing. It's not right and wrong. It actually has nothing to do with morality or right or wrong at all. What integrity is to be whole. It is to be who you say you are. A person with integrity is somebody who lives the beliefs that they claim, period. Even and especially when the price for living them is high. And when you look at this, I mean, a bunch of you guys have mentioned sacrifice so far today. I think this is one of the biggest things that we're wrestling with right now is, man, we love to, you know, we love to do things when it's this comfortable environment. But, you know, as soon as we go out there and all of a sudden having to do this culture stuff, like you start having to pay a heavy price for it, all of a sudden my belief in it starts to weaken. And that's when that belief actually has to be strong. Otherwise, it's just too shaky. Okay? Next one. Beliefs are expressed or they are hidden. There's nothing that destroys a clubhouse faster than a hidden agenda. Because it's from where all the nasty stuff comes. So sometimes people believe things, but they don't say it out loud. They keep it to themselves, which is why we say watch behavior. Because if I'm doing this right here, but I'm actually behaving like that, I'll distract you with this and then act down here. I'm trusting this. I'm trusting the action. And so putting the beliefs on the table is one of the fastest ways to start recognizing people who believe like we do, people who don't believe like we do, then we can start putting it in alignment. Next one. You believe in improvement or you believe in ego. You have to pick which one is more important to you. You're gonna vault one over the other. And notice the simplicity of it, that the faster you can make that decision, the better. Because to improve is gonna come at the expense of what? And to maintain your ego is gonna come at the expense of what? Some of your improvement. So we just have to pick. And you can watch guys, right? Isn't it fairly easy to observe guys who vault ego over improvement? Can't you watch that? That's the uncoachable guy. It's the resistant guy. And then you can see the guys who are improvement over ego. It's also pretty easy and direct to observe. So you put these two things out. Next, we believe in team or individual. There is room for both. We have to set the priority order. We've got to set, will the team sacrifice itself to serve the individual, or will the individual sacrifice something to serve the team? We got to pick one. It doesn't mean you don't believe in yourself. It just means which one is the priority. because the other one is going to get set back a little bit. And then this one, I think this is my favorite. There's a difference between the belief to go win and the belief to not lose. Go win is a pursuit. And this is where I've put this out and I've shared this a handful of times. Not everybody gets this, and that's okay. But some people will. And that's this. There's a difference between somebody who likes to compete and somebody who likes to win. Who likes to win? No, I don't mean in this room. I know, yeah. I mean like in the world, who likes to win? Everybody likes to win. Of course, winning's fun. Winning's enjoyable. Who likes to compete, which is uncertainty, hard, intense, fight. It's against somebody else. You may not be the best one. As soon as you start making it competition rather than winning, all of a sudden the people who say they like it dwindles real fast. And so here's what I've been laying out for people. I think that people who only like to win are actually big losers. People who love to compete, that's a winner. The difference is this. When you compete, you risk the chance of losing. And that's what the nature of competition is. People who only like to compete are front runners who only compete really hard when they know they're gonna win or they have the best chance to win. Competitors step into the arena no matter what's going on. They step into the arena no matter what's happening and they're ready to compete. They have no idea if they're gonna win or lose. They just want a shot to go chase that win down. You put a room full of competitors together, that's a hungry group. That's an intense group. Put a room full of people who just like to win and next thing you know, what? 3 months in and we're not winning a whole lot and it's kind of boring and hard, we're not winning, it's like, whoop, effort level drops. Competitor levels go up. Front runners, they go down. I think that's the biggest difference between here. The biggest difference is people who want to go win, that's a competitor. Let's go chase that thing down. And if it's 3 years away, let's start right now today.